Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I pray that you and your families and your loved ones and everyone as a whole is healthy, well, and keeping safe during these times. A lot has happened within this past week where we've seen slowly but surely the offices of government as well as medical health experts through the CDC and others becoming stricter in what they're telling us and what they're giving us of details and information. And part of what we've also seen within this time is that many of the masajid, which were not closed in the way that IENT was closed from Thursday night, that they have all, for the most part, closed as of today, Tuesday, the 17th of March. What I want to do tonight with you and these is to begin a process of addressing you as the community. I'm sure you have questions, you have concerns, and we're perhaps even a little bit late in this, but just so that you're assured, it's not that we're on vacation or anything else. Rather, the imams in the DFW area as a whole, we are communicating on a daily basis. And together, collectively, we are looking at what we can possibly do in light of all that's taking place to still meet the religious and spiritual needs of the community. So tonight, the first thing that I want to mention is this, is that with regards to what we're doing, we want to understand that Islam as a whole, in the sense of general evidence, focuses on the same aspect of what we're finding government and health agencies as they hold telling us, which is to pay attention, to make sure that we are protecting ourselves to minimize disease. When we look at maqasidu sharia, the intents of what our Islamic law focus on, and we know that we're told that there are five things: hifdhu nafs, protection of life; wa hifdhu deen, the protection of religion; wa hifdhu al-aila or al-nasl, the protection of family, progeny; wa hifdhu al-mal, as well as protection of wealth; wa hifdhu al-aql, protection of learning and intelligence. We understand that without life, you can't have any of those other things. So in essence, the protection of life is really at the base of it all. And so Islam, the general teachings, the primary focus is to ensure that life as a whole, the sanctity of life, that it is being protected. And in this case, what we're looking at is the aspect of what we learn from what is also from Islam, of again general evidence. We have the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, which is the hadith of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, where he tells us that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam said, لا ضرر ولا ضرار, where he tells us that there is no harm to be in any way taken on or to be reciprocated, among the different translations of what that short but powerful statement means. So what we're learning from this is that with regards to the aspect of harm and what can be dangerous, that there's two approaches to it. The first is al-biqaya, is to prevent it. And the second is to deal with the aftermath once it occurs. So I want us to understand that in the approach that imams as a whole have taken of shutting down the masajid, and as we see that it's not just here in the DFW area, that it is not just nationally, but it is internationally, right? That what we are doing is looking to preserve human life. Understanding that that's the greatest teaching, that's the greatest command that we have, and therefore that the community as a whole, inshallah ta'ala, that you are on the same page with us, that you are working with us. And we're going to try to keep these videos short just because we know that there's so many other things that you are busy with. Here's one of the things that we'll say second to last as far as conclusion. Our brothers who have been so used to coming to the masjid regularly, take this as an opportunity to get a feel for what our sisters have been dealing with for such a long time. Right? When we think about the expectation for us to be able to just naturally come to the masjid and have the accommodation of the masjid, well, we know that this hasn't always really been the case for our sisters. And still, till today, many of our masajids are not really as welcoming, as accommodating towards our sisters. So maybe among the lessons in this is that we can learn to better appreciate what we have and really be on the same side for our sisters to ensure that they are also going to be taken care of and that they're also going to be paid attention to. The last thing that we'll mention is this. We understand that our iman is impacted and affected in a way that when we are not able to come to the masjid and we're not able to worship together as a community, as a congregation, that it weakens our faith in some ways. As some folks have even said, I feel, you know, a bit depressed, etc. We don't want anybody to be getting depressed because of this or otherwise. But what we do want you to understand is, once again, the value of what you have. And this is where hardship sometimes is in and of itself a tremendous gift from Allahu Rabbul Alameen, because the only way we really can see things is when we have something to compare it to. So when we're looking at this aspect of now being deprived and seeing and feeling, experiencing directly ourselves the effects of it on our faith and our spiritual well-being, well, we come to realize that this is something that really needs to be cherished and that it needs to be maintained, and that we all need to collectively do our part to make sure that, not just for me, but in the general sense, that we have to move away from that mindset of just thinking about myself and really looking at the general masses. And this is where we can once again look to see that, alhamdulillah, that Allah's houses are for everybody, and that inshallah ta'ala we need to maintain them, we need to make sure that they're welcoming and accommodating for everyone. And once we do come back, and inshallah ta'ala we come back quickly, that we work together in a way that continues to foster the love, the brotherhood and sisterhood, and the maintaining of Allahu Azza wa Jal's houses in the most beautiful way. And I pray that Allah Ta'ala answer these prayers and keep you and all of us safe and well. Allahumma ameen. We'll conclude with just this one dua of what you can do to be a bit more proactive, inshallah. We have the hadith that is in Abu Dawood and many of the other books of Sunnah. And Shaykh al-Albani rahmatullah alayhi declares this hadith to be authentic, where in Aban ibn Uthman ibn Affan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, the son of Uthman ibn Affan radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he tells us that his father said to him that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, whoever says Bismillah alladhi la yadurru ma'a ismihi shay'un fil ardi wala fis sama'i wa huwa as-sami'ul 'alim, that whoever says this supplication with belief naturally in the morning 3 times and in the evening 3 times, that nothing will harm them by Allah's will. And the dua states, in the name of Allah, with whom there is nothing in the heavens or on earth that can harm, and Allah is the all-hearing, the all-knowing. Let us practice this as we are worshiping together at home as a congregation to make up for what we don't have in the masjid. Let us make sure that after Fajr and after Maghrib that we are saying this dua, that we are committing it to memory, and that we are committing it to our life practice. Until then, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.